today we're looking at one of the OCR core studies, and that is by Baron-Cohen, Joliffe, Mortimer and Robertson. And it's about advanced theory of mind tests, okay, looking at high-functioning adults with autism or Asperger's syndrome and whether they appear to have an impaired theory of mind or not. This study comes from the cognitive approach, so it's about thought processes, internal mental processes, and whether you can explain the difficulties experienced by individuals with autism in terms of a problem with their cognitive processes. And specifically, he's interested in whether they have an impaired theory of mind. Remember, theory of mind is the ability to understand what other people are thinking and feeling. Okay. So the specific aims of the experiment were to use an adult test of theory of mind competence. Okay, this was a new test, the reading the eyes task, and they wanted to see if it would work or not. To look for support for the cognitive explanation of autism and whether or not autistic adults appeared to show any deficit in theory of mind skills. A secondary aim of the experiment, and they were also interested in whether females would perform better than males, which is what they were predicting would happen on the theory of mind task, the reading the eyes task. Okay, so it's an experiment, therefore there are independent and dependent variables. In this case, the independent variable was the group they fell into. So it's a naturally occurring independent variable. So they were either in the autistic group, in the Tourette syndrome control group, or in the normal control group. So there were three different aspects of the independent variable. The dependent variable was their performance on the eyes task. There were also three other tasks that some of the groups completed, and the results of that were also counted as dependent variables. I'll talk a bit more about those later. So, I mentioned there that there was a Tourette's syndrome group, not just a normal control group. And one of the things they may ask you about is why Baron-Cohen chose to use participants with Tourette's syndrome. Why not just the normal control group? And there are various reasons for that. There were some similarities, or there are some similarities, between Tourette syndrome and autism, and therefore he felt using that group would help to control some of the extraneous variables. For example, okay, they both had normal intelligence, they had both suffered with this disorder from childhood, they both had disorders that disrupted schooling and peer relations and made it much harder to form relationships with peers. Both disorders are supposed to originate in frontal lobe abnormalities, and in both cases there is definitely an element of genetics involved. Okay, and both are also more commonly in males than in females. Okay, they also ensured that participants in both the Tourette syndrome group and the autistic group had already passed the theory of mind test based on 6-year-old theory of mind skills, so the Sally Ann task. Okay, the method and design. It's an independent measures design, which means each participant only takes part in one aspect of the independent variable. Now, considering this is a quasi-experiment and therefore the independent variable is naturally occurring, it kind of goes without saying because they can't be in both the autistic group and the normal control group. It's a snapshot study because it takes place over one period of time, the opposite of longitudinal. So who exactly are the participants? So as I said, there were three different groups. All had normal intelligence, although in the normal control group it was assumed they had normal intelligence. They didn't actually test them, but they did test the intelligence, the IQ of both the autistic group and the Tourette syndrome group. In the autistic group, there were 16 adults, 13 males, 3 females. And although that might not seem like a kind of balance between the genders, that does reflect more the distribution of people with autism within the population as a whole. They were recruited through an advert in the National Autistic Society magazine, as well as through doctors and clinics. So it's a self-selected sample. The normal adults, there were 50 normal adults, 25 males and 25 females, drawn from Cambridge. The university has a subject panel there, and those people were randomly drawn from that subject panel. So that was a random sampling method. And the final group, the Tourette's syndrome group, there were 10 adults in that group, 8 males and 2 females, again, probably reflecting the sorry, again reflecting the representation of it within the population as a whole, they were age matched to the autistic group, and they were recruited via a clinic in London. So again, it's a self-selected sample. So just to make clear, groups 2 and 3 were controls to see if normal adults could cope with the theory of mind tasks. And specifically, they had the Tourette syndrome group to see if individuals with other developmental disorders could cope with the reading the mind tasks. Okay, they had some hypotheses, some predictions that they'd made about it. The first one was that patients with Tourette syndrome would be unimpaired on this advanced theory of mind test, but the subjects with autism or Asperger's syndrome would show a significant impairment on this test. Second hypothesis, subjects who had difficulties when completing the eyes task would also have difficulties when completing the strange stories task. And finally, just like I said, the secondary aim was comparing males and females. They predicted that normal females may be superior to normal males in emotion perception. So in terms of the procedure, what they actually did, the main thing they were interested in was the eyes task. So they had 25 photographs of the eye region of both males and females. They had some controls in place. All the photographs were black and white. They were all made the same size, 15 by 10 centimetres. And they use the same region of the face, so from midway along the nose to just above the eyebrow. So they're not showing more or less of some people's faces. What the participant had to do, they got 3 seconds to look at each photograph, and then they had a forced choice between two words, okay, to decide what the person in the photograph might be thinking or feeling, excuse me. Some of the emotions that they had a choice between were basic. Okay, so the basic emotions are things like happy, sad, angry, neutral, and some were more complex. For example, arrogant or scheming. The forced choices were between opposites. So I've got some examples on the next slide here. So that first one is reflective versus unreflective. So that's a more complex emotion. And the other one is sympathetic versus unsympathetic. If you're particularly keen to try out the eyes task yourself, if you Google reading the eyes task, you should be able to come up with some pages where you can have a go at the test online yourself. In terms of the results, they found a significant difference between the autistic group, Asperger's syndrome group, and the normal and Tourette syndrome group. You can see there 16.3 on average correct answers at 25 versus 20.3 and 20.4. So there's no significant difference between the normal and the Tourette syndrome group. The ranges were fairly similar. Asperger's syndrome had a range from 13 to 23, whereas the controls between 16 and 25. The one thing you'll notice, the fact that it goes from 16 to 25 means you've hit a ceiling effect there. Okay, a number of participants in the control group scored full marks, and therefore it implies the tests may be slightly too easy. Okay, something Baron-Cohen went on to do is to devise a slightly more difficult, challenging reading the eyes task where he gave a fixed choice of 4 possible answers to try and make it a bit more challenging to see if perhaps there's a more significant difference between the autistic group and the control groups. But that was a later experiment. Okay. What they also then got to do is the Tourette syndrome group and the Asperger's and autistic group then had to complete a second theory of mind task. Now, this was not completed by the normal participants, and this was the strange stories task. Now, the point of carrying this out was to validate the eyes task. What they thought was, if they were impaired on the reading the eyes task, they would also be impaired on the strange stories task. Okay, so I gave some examples from the strange stories task in my previous video, but basically participants answered questions on the brief story they were given, and they were either about what the characters were thinking, which was the theory of mind questions, or about physical events. And what they found was the Tourette syndrome group made no errors on the thinking questions, whereas the autistic and Asperger's group made significant number of errors. So the results matched what they found on the eyes task, and that means it gives it concurrent validity. Okay, you have more confidence that the reading the eyes task is really measuring theory of mind, because you get the same results as you do on the strange stories task, which is also measuring theory of mind. They got the autistic and Asperger's syndrome group to complete 2 more tests, which they didn't get any of the other groups to do. The first one of those was gender recognition of the eyes. Okay, so only completed by the autistic group. And here, all they had to do was identify the gender of the eyes as being either male or female. Okay, so this is not testing theory of mind. This is just about face perception to see if they're impaired on face perception or not. And what they found was that participants performed normally on this task. Okay, the second task they got just the autistic group to do was what's called a basic emotion recognition task. This time, they had images of the whole face and they just had to identify the basic emotions on those whole faces. Again, this wasn't measuring theory of mind. This is just about recognizing simple emotional states. And what they found was that participants performed normally on this task. In terms of other results, remember I said a secondary aim was to see whether males performed worse than females. And what they found is that they did. In the normal groups, the females performed significantly better than the males, implying that females are better on theory or kind of superior on theory of mind tests, which is what they were expecting. But the normal males with autism or Asperger's syndrome, okay, and the normal males without performed significantly better than the males with autism or Asperger's syndrome. So what did they conclude as a result of this experiment? They concluded that adults with autism and Asperger's syndrome are impaired on the theory of mind test. And as it was only that group that made errors on the eyes task and the strange stories task, it has concurrent validity. It does seem to be measuring what they wanted it to measure, which was theory of mind. Normal females perform better than normal males on the theory of mind test. And importantly, intelligence is not linked with performance, okay? As it says there, some of the autistic group had university degrees, so it's not saying that they're not intelligent if they're not doing well on these theory of mind tasks, just that they appear to have a deficit in that particular skill. So we'll be talking about the evaluation in next lesson, so try to have a think through. Can you think of any strengths? Can you think of any weaknesses of this particular experiment? And we'll be discussing that next lesson.